Okay, the Word of God is powerful, it's living, it's active, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It's a three-dimensional book. When we open it up, we're not just opening up flat pages, where it is a living experience. And I'm sure many of you would have had powerful experiences in the Word of God. One time when I was a young man working as a sandwich artist at Subway, I was... That's what they call you, sandwich artist. It was on my payslip. I was serving a customer and we're just making a sub. And he said, oh, what have you been up to? And I said, oh, I've just been to church today. And he said, oh, well, look, I don't believe in God. But and I said, oh, look, in the heart of all men is the knowledge of God. And he said, oh, look, yeah, no, I believe in God. But and I just thought in that second, that man, from me quoting one scripture, has gone from atheist to to at least a theist. I thought, boy, he can't be too, maybe this guy can jump straight to a Christian by the end of the, I got to the till, right? And all I'd done was actually just use a scripture, right? In a paraphrased way, you know, because God doesn't believe in atheists. There's no such thing, right? They're suppressing the truth and unrighteousness. Ray Comfort, one of my heroes, he always uses the phrase, he said, look, atheists can't find God for the same reason that a criminal can't find a police officer, right? It's something in the will, right? And a great philosopher said, there's none so blind but those who will not see, right? It's those who will not see. They're the real blind ones. And so look, the Word of God is powerful. Let's not get complacent with the Word of God. We're coming to the Holy Scriptures. We're actually coming to one of the greatest letters written of all time. And in fact, in secular historians, when they look at the letter to the Romans, they actually rate it incredibly highly too. The way it's written, the intellectual ability, the way it's structured, it is an incredible treatise. It's a beautiful letter. But Paul didn't write it for beauty. Paul wrote it for a number of reasons. Remember, Paul had finished his work amongst the Corinthians and the Ephesians and the Philippians, and he was looking for new fields. And I think he thought, well, Rome's the center of the known world, and if I can get a ministry base in Rome, then the whole world can be impacted by the gospel, and also it would be a launching pad to the west and to Spain and to other places. And Paul sort of, he wanted to finish what God had called him to do. You know, just like I said earlier, Paul had met with God, And Jesus himself had appeared to him and called him and even said to him, look, you're going to suffer many things. Right from the outset, Jesus was right up front. But he said, you're going to be like a light to the Gentiles. You're going to open blind eyes. And Paul wanted to do that. He didn't want to build on another man's foundation. He didn't want to go around to just regular churches on a preaching circuit. He wanted to go to a new field and plant churches in a new field. So he's sort of getting towards, you know, the later days in his life, and he's thinking, I've got to get to Rome. But that's not the only reason he wrote this letter to the Romans. And what was actually happening in Rome, Paul saw as an incredible threat. The church was about to go from one denomination to potentially two denominations. Two denominations? Well, they say there's up to 40,000 denominations today, depending how you split the pie, right? They were all met in the upper room in one accord, and today 40,000, right? Because when we disagree, we start our own little groups, rather than when we disagree, we could all still meet together and say, that's secondary, we focus on the gospel, and we'll nut out the rest while we're here, right? We'll battle it out. Iron sharpens iron, right? But Paul was desperately worried that there was going to become two denominations, that the church that began in one accord, as the Gentiles were grafted into the body, that the Jew and the Gentile church would split into two. He didn't want to see that happen. And in fact, the instigators of that wasn't the Jews, who were the original members of the church. It was the Gentiles. This is how it happened. The Jews would have heard the gospel, and we know there was a couple of Jewish Romans on the day of Pentecost. We get that in the book of Acts. They would have travelled back to Rome, started a church, and the church became quite a strong Jewish church. There was about 40 to 60,000, not church members, but Jewish people that were living in Rome under Claudius, the Emperor Claudius. And after a while, Claudius said, I don't want the Jews in the country anymore, and he kicked them all out. Now, you've got a church that's filled with Jews, filled with Jewish leadership, with the Jewish flavor. And there were Gentiles that were added to the number, but they might have only been, say, 5% of the church. The Jews are all kicked out, and now there's just this little church of Gentiles. But the Gentiles, by the grace of God, had rebuilt that church. And in fact, their faith, it's recorded in the scriptures, was known throughout the whole known world, right? Their faith was being spoken of, right? The church that began, as one person put it, with no apostle and no miracles, had itself, just from hearing the gospel on the day of Pentecost, had grown despite incredible persecution, where they lost maybe, you know, 90 to 95% of its number, had grown. Now, a new emperor comes in, Nero, and he thinks, well, the Jews are great with money, and they are. And he invites them back into Rome to help for economic reasons, commerce reasons, and the Jews come back, but now here they are with this Gentile church. And the Gentiles have got this question mark in the back of their minds. And this question mark has not gone away for 2,000 years and becomes more prominent in the days we're living in now than in any other time except for maybe in Paul's time. And the question mark is God done with the Jews? Hasn't God, you know, God used the Jews, but then they rejected him. How dare they? They put Jesus on a cross. And now the gospel has gone to the Gentiles. They had their chance. They've been cut off. And now we're the main show. In fact, you'll hear it in language today, like we're the new Israel. Right? There's a technical name for it, replacement theology. Has Israel actually been replaced? Paul thought it was so serious that he writes this, well, the biggest letter that we have in the scriptures, and the most powerful letter in the scriptures, and one of the most powerful arguments against God being done with the Jew. So Paul sees that, wow, if in Rome the Jews and the Gentile church splits and we've got two denominations. He worries that will become contagious because, you know, all roads lead to Rome. What the Romans do, everyone else is going to do. So he's greatly concerned. He wants to get to this church. He can't. He's on his way to Jerusalem. He gets delayed due to weather. He's trying to get to Rome. He can't. All he's got is a pen, right? But he's got pen and the Holy Spirit, and that's all you need. If you're an apostle, you can write scriptures. And that's what he did. And he writes this letter. So that's the basis. When we look at the book of Romans, we need to have that overview. We need to have that picture, right? Every time you pick up the book of the Bible, we should have an overview and a picture in our mind. Well, what am I reading here? What context? Does this book come before that or after that? Obviously, at the heart of everything that we read needs to be that one question. What can I get to know about God through this scripture? But if we don't know where this actually places, why is he talking about Jew here and Gentile there and being cut off and he's a stumbling block? And you're like, what on earth is all this? But when we get into context, when we understand what Paul's trying to do, then it makes a whole lot more sense. How's the book of Romans structured? Well, it's got trilogies upon trilogies within it, right? Trilogies are quite popular these days, but they're real popular. They're popular in the scriptures. You know, the Sermon on the Mount is a trilogy, Matthew 4, 5, and 6. Ezekiel 37, 38, 39, another trilogy. There's on spiritual gifts, you've got 12, 13, 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14. There's many trilogies, right? But in the book of Romans, and we've just gone from chapters 1 to 8, we've actually finished the first part of the trilogy, right? So chapters 1 to 8, then we have chapters 9 to 11, and then chapters 12 to 16. And the way that you can split these chapters up is that the first 8 are related to faith or doctrine. The second one, hope, the future, dispensationalism, the return, what happens in the future with Israel. And the last 4 from 12 to 16 is talking about love, practical things, practical instructions, faith, hope, and love. So it's almost, Paul is so permeated by faith, hope, and love that when he's writing this letter, that it's sort of coming out in his writing as well, or it was deliberate. And if that's the case, he would have an incredibly brilliant mind. We also see Father, Son, and Holy Spirit as we walk through those scriptures. So when we looked into the verses 1 to 8, and the reason why I'm just laying this platform here now is because it's important, because since we're now stepping into a new chapter, which is really the core of why Romans is written, 9 to 11 is the core of why Paul wrote this letter, we need to sort of understand what's gone behind, right? So Paul begins, he thinks, well, hang on, this church doesn't know me. I've never visited it. How on earth am I going to tell them, you guys, you're doing the wrong thing. You need to accept the Jews. God's not done with them yet. That's what he needs to say to them. How does he do that? Well, he begins by developing a platform to show that Jew and Gentile are all on the same basis, right? So in the first three chapters, he talks about sin. Chapter four, he says, chapter three, he says, everyone's a sinner. The Jew, you know, they got the law and they kept breaking it. Gentiles didn't have the law and they just broke it according to their conscience, right? In chapter four, he brings a common solution. Jesus is the savior, both of Gentile and of Jew, right? So he's saying, hey, you guys are all in the same, you guys all sin, but hey, and you've all got the one savior. Jews aren't saved through the law and you're saved through some other way, right? You're all on the same basis. In chapter five, he introduces the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is for all those who believe. Chapter six, he puts his target towards the Gentiles and talks about sin or licentiousness, right? For the Gentile, we are more likely to be tempted into licentiousness, right? Into sin. For the Jew, more likely to be tempted into legalism, which he addresses in chapter 7. So he aims for the Gentile first and says, hey, look, don't backslide into the things that you used to do. That's what he says. Then to the Jew, he says, hey, don't backslide back into the law. Stop getting legalism. You're not saved by that. The law's amazing. Nothing wrong with it. It's fantastic. Not one jot or tittle will disappear. That's absolutely true. But it cannot save you. It cannot save you. And for the Gentile, they thought they could just live whatever way they liked and still go to heaven. But without holiness, no man will see the Lord, right? So Paul is putting them all on the same basis by saying they've all got problems, they're all sinners, they all need a saviour. When he gets to chapter 8, he brings the common solution. The common solution is life in the Spirit. And that's what we looked at a couple of weeks ago when we looked at Romans 8. Romans 8 is an incredibly encouraging, incredibly powerful book. It mentions the Holy Spirit about, I think about 29 times or so, 27 times. And there's only about three other mentions outside of that in the previous seven chapters or so. So he mentions life in the Spirit. He talks about the Spirit. And to sum it all up, he says, what you've got to do is you must not walk according to the works of the flesh, but you must put them to death. Put them to death by the Spirit, not by your own strength. Doesn't work. That's sort of like legalism, right? But by the power of the Spirit, by your relationship with the Lord, by standing before God and receiving his power every day through reading his word, through praying, through doing his work, you become strong. Your muscles become strong spiritually. And then you're able to put to death the deeds of the body. You don't want anything to do with them. You start to hate the things you used to love. You start to love the things you used to hate, right? And that's the life of the Spirit. Okay, so he's done the groundwork now. And now he's coming into chapters 9, 10, and 11. And the final thing I'll say on that is that the way to look at chapters 9, 10, and 11, they're roughly split. It's not exactly, because chapters and verses didn't come into around the 13th century, right? But it's roughly split into three areas. First, he's talking to the Jews and he's saying they were selected sovereignly. God chose the Jews. God chose. He chose his friend. Abraham was his friend. He chose his friend. He said, I'm going to do something here. Okay? See, God chose sovereignly. And that is... And if we look at that, so that's chapter 9 that we're looking at today, and that's talking about the past. It then talks about the present in chapter 10, and it's saying what the problem that the Jews have now is that you now have a stumbling block. Jesus is a stumbling block for the Jew, and in fact, it's the Gentiles that are standing on that stumbling block while the Jew is tripping over it at the moment, right? The Jew can't accept Jesus. They're blinded. They're blocked. They can't get it. They don't understand. They want their works. They want the law. They want all these blessings that God gave them as a nation to be enough to be able to get them into heaven. And Paul comes along and says, no, the gospel is that stuff doesn't get you into heaven. And that they're like, how dare you? You know, what a dirty Gentile can come into the kingdom, yet us with all the law and whatnot, we can't. You know, we say, well, I'm not saying that, but you must come through Jesus Christ, just like they must. But the Jew trips over that. That's not good enough for them. They trip over that. What? Jesus, he died in Nazareth. He died in weak. We're looking for a victorious king like David. Well, the one who died in weakness on a cross, that's a stumbling block to the Jew. They don't get it. They're looking for a mighty Messiah. They don't understand that he must be a suffering servant. The first time he comes, second time he comes as the all-conquering king and Messiah. He comes in the spirit of Joseph the first time, Joseph who was thrown into the pit, betrayed by his brethren, right, just like Jesus, who then got promoted to the right hand of the Pharaoh, just like Jesus did, right? Jesus must first come like the suffering servant Joseph before he can come like the king David, right, in the millennial reign. And the Jew couldn't quite get that, so chapter 10 is talking about the present. Jesus is a stumbling block. In chapter 11, it's talking about the future. And it's all summed up in this one scripture, this one thing that Paul pens when he says, and all Israel will be saved. Right? And we're going to unpack that. Because the word for saved there is the same plain old word for saved everywhere. Saved, it's the same word used to be saved by the blood of Jesus. It's the same word used for the Jew there. So that's going to be fascinating. What does it mean all Israel will be saved, right? But we'll get there in chapter 11. But that's where Paul is building to. So we're looking at past today, present next week. And we'll, there's something different happening next week, but in our next teaching and then in the future, we'll be looking at chapter 11, which is about the future. So that's just giving you a bit of a map to negotiate. So let's get into these scriptures. So verse 1, I tell you the truth in Christ, I'm not lying. My conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and continual grief in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my countrymen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertain the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, and the promises, of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, the eternally blessed God. Amen. Paul is just wreaked with sorrow. This is what he's wanting to get to. He uses incredibly severe language. The word accursed means damned to hell. He said, oh, look, if I could swap my place for their place, if my fellow countrymen, instead of stumbling over Jesus, would accept Jesus, I would take hell in their place if that could happen, right? It couldn't happen. But it just shows the depth of love that Paul had. He was broken, the fact that so many Jews had rejected Jesus, right? He was identifying with the Gentiles. They'd probably seen this too. And he's trying to say, hey guys, I get it. You're disappointed with the Jews and you don't want to really let them back into your church. I am more so. I would go to hell if they could go to heaven, right? That's, that's Paul's heart. Paul was, so the Gentiles here would be wondering if his words about nothing separating us from the love of God, which he's just said in Romans chapter 8, applied to the Jews as well. They certainly seem to have fallen from favor. The Gentiles would be thinking, look, I think Paul emphasized all those blessings that came through the Jews there. He talks about, hey, they were given the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law. They have the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They had Jesus Christ came through their line. So he's trying to say, hey, don't forget them. I'm grieved too. Don't forget them. Don't think for a second. Don't let that question mark in the back of your mind. Oh, maybe we've replaced them. Maybe God's done with Israel, right? That's what Paul's trying to get to here. And he goes on to say in verse 6, but it is not that the word of God has taken no effect, for they are not all Israel who were of Israel. So he's saying, look, it's not that people are going, well, if that's the case, what? If it's not God's plan that Israel have not continued, right, then is it the word of God that's failed? Right? Paul is always answering these, these ridiculous suggestions. Well, are you saying this, St. Paul? Are you trying to say, well, it's obviously the word of God's got a problem. You don't think there's a problem with the Jews? Well, there must be a problem with the word of God. And he says, no. You don't get it, right? It's not, it is not that the word of God has taken no effect. Isaiah said, the word of God does not return void. For they are not all Israel who are of Israel, nor are they all children, because they are of the seed of Abraham. But in Isaac your seed shall be called. That is, those who are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted as the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time I will come, and Sarah shall have a son. Now that sounds, you're like, what is all that about, right? But basically what he's saying is that, hey, you're looking at Israel. You're looking at all Israel as a nation. They didn't quite have a nation there then, but they were a group of people. And you're looking at them and going, oh, well, God's obviously done with them. You know, they haven't received the Savior. You know, they look how they're living. They're persecuting us. The Jews were persecuting the Gentiles, Gentile Christians and Jewish Christians as well. And they were thinking, yeah, God's done with them. But Paul's, you're thinking about it differently. You've got to stop thinking in these racist terms, Jew and Gentile. You've got to stop thinking like that. Right? Just because one's a Jew doesn't mean that he's one spiritually. They're not all sons of Abraham. In fact, Jesus said to the Pharisees said, our fathers are Abraham. He said, your father's the devil. Right? That's what he said. That's pretty, have you ever said that when you're witnessing to someone? Hey, no, look, I believe in the same God you do. No, your father's the devil. You know, I believe in the true God. So Jesus said that clearly. So what he's saying here is that you've got to start thinking spiritually. Stop thinking about these natural differences, a Jewish nation, a Gentile, other nations, right? That now, when you look at the Jewish nation, there's some within that nation that follow God. They're the part of the children of promise that came from Isaac. Do you remember the other child that Abraham had? Ishmael, right? He actually had three wives and he had five children after that as well. So he's actually had seven children, Abraham. But he started with Ishmael, firstborn, but out of wedlock. Secondborn was Isaac to his wife, Sarah, that's the one. And then he had five more after that. But what he's saying is that, well, just because you're from the seed of Abraham, it doesn't mean that you're not from Ishmael's line rather than Isaac's line. Right? Ishmael is a picture of the flesh. And Isaac is a picture of the promise. Why? Because where was the faith when Abraham, you know, takes up Sarah's suggestion and says, oh, look, sleep with the handmaiden, Hagar. Yep. She got all the names today. and that way you'll have a child because Sarah's too old and you guys, this is not going to work, right? Well, let's help God out a bit. It seems nuts. But then again, what, she was about 100? And they're saying, you'll have a baby. Sorry? 80, okay. So that was... She was old. That's right. But God had said it would happen. So what did they do? They tried to do it their way. And often, you know, what we do is, it's not like we're not trying to do God's will. We do God's will, but we do it in our own strength, our own way, in our own flesh, don't we? Right, that's what was happening here. So this is the delineation Paul makes. He goes, you don't get it. When you look at Israel, you've got to realize that's not just a representative of, of Abraham's seed, right? This, some are of the flesh, some are of the spirit. You know, when we witness to Muslims, they'll often say, they'll look at the West, they'll look at Australia and go, you're a Christian nation, but look at all these drunks and look at all this and look, how's it? And I said, no, that's not Christian. And it's difficult for us to try and communicate. No. You know, this is a secular country and we are Christians within it, right? It's difficult for them to see. They look upon, you know, because with Sharia law, it's a political system as well, right? Islam is political as much as it is religious and has all kinds of laws for daily life and whatnot, right? It takes over every area of your life. So, you know, they say Saudi Arabia would be a Muslim country and they sort of think, so everyone is declared sort of a Muslim there, right? So they think Australia or America, that's a Christian country, and they sort of see it the same way. Well, that's what the Gentiles were doing here. They were looking at the Jews and going, what? You know, God's done with them, right? And he's saying, don't write them all off. Don't write them all off. There's people of the Jews who are part of the children of faith. He explains it further in verse 10. He says, not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one man, even by our father Isaac, for the children not yet being born, nor having any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him who calls. That was a mouthful. It was said to her, the older shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob I have loved, but Esau I have hated. So now he's saying, well, even in the next generation, right, Jacob, the Isaac's son, right, and Jacob and Esau were twins, right, Isaac's children. And they fought in the womb. And Jacob's name means deceiver, and he sort of got the upper hand. And at the end of Isaac's life, Jacob deceives Isaac into getting the blessing when Esau was the firstborn child and should have got the blessing. However, also, Esau sold his birthright for a bowl of soup or stew, basically, to Jacob earlier as well. And we laugh and we mock at that, and then we think, you know, what sins of the flesh do we engage in, you know, when we're meant to be thinking about eternal life? What sins do we prefer over eternity and, you know, and God sometimes too? So, but what the point that he's making here is he's saying, look, before they were even born, God just said, I'm going to choose that child. I'm just going to choose. Before Jacob could do any good or any bad, he said, I'm choosing him. The world would have chosen the firstborn, but God said, no, I'm going to make it my choice. I'm going to choose the secondborn. I'm going to choose Jacob. By choosing Jacob before he was born, God ensured that never a gospel or religion of works could ever rise up. Right? By God choosing to make Jacob's offspring to become a nation, to bring the Messiah and display his glory, not based on Jacob's character or goodness, it meant that forever God's people would always be those who were saved by grace through faith. Do you get that? In the fact that God didn't just allow Esau, the firstborn, naturally to do it, or he didn't pick someone who was really good. He said, before they're born, before they can do good or bad, I'm just sovereignly choosing this person. Why did he do that? It's because that person or any of their offspring could not boast. Like, no one can say, yeah, but, oh, well, you know, Lord, we should be blessed because Jacob's our forefather. And God's like, yeah, he's a deceiver. What are you talking about? I chose to bless. I chose to bring the Messiah through his line. You got no boast. And that carries through to the gospel too, right? The gospel in which we stand cannot be based on works at all. It cannot be based on any human effort. It cannot be based on our own goodness. Right from the beginning, remember, the gospel, the Messiah, comes from this line, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, right? So when God's selecting who he's going to choose, and he can choose whoever he likes because he's got free will too, you know? I get to choose my friends. God can choose his friends, right? People say, well, did he favor the Israelites? Well, do I favor my wife over another woman? Well, I don't know if that's called favoritism, but I've got a special relationship with my wife I don't have with other people. Is that wrong or sinful? No. We can have special relationships, and God can have special relationships. He deals with everyone fairly. He doesn't deal with us partially either, right? But he chose a nation as an instrument. That nation has had to suffer like you wouldn't believe, but it's also had the blessing of having the Lord Jesus Christ come through, right? So God chooses Jacob for that reason. In verse 14, he says this, what shall we say then? And this is where he gets into the meat. And we're actually going to read 10 verses now, and we're going to deal with it all as one big chunk. So, you know, strap in or whatever they say. What shall we say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? And Paul says, certainly not, or forbid the thought. For he says to Moses, I will have mercy on whomever I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whomever I will have compassion. So then it is not of him who wills, so it's not of us, nor of him who runs, who does the work, but of God who shows mercy, right? God wanted the glory. So God sovereignly chose who he was going to bring the Messiah through and the blessing and the gospel through. For the scripture says, just before I move to Pharaoh here, I just want to make it clear. When the Bible says, Jacob I loved and Esau I hated, God doesn't hate anyone, right? He doesn't hate individuals. When we read that passage, we've got to read it in context. He's talking about nations. He's talking about Israel, right? So what he's talking about is he's talking about the hatred he has for Esau's, he becomes the father of a nation, the Edomites. And in Ezekiel 35, you can read of their destruction because they were greatly wicked. They actually helped the Babylonians bring the Israelites into captivity. They did many, many, many wicked things. And eventually God judges them with destruction. He created them in a sense, or he allowed them, he knew what they would do, and he allowed them or created them in a sense to be a vessel of destruction. But does that mean that Edomites can't be saved? No, the individual Edomites, God has not crafted any of them for destruction. Individuals aren't crafted for destruction. God so loved the world that he sent his only son, right? So when God is saying, you know, Esau I hated and Jacob I loved, he's saying, Jacob, which is the nation of Israel, I've loved in the sense that I have chosen to bring salvation. I've decided to bring the Messiah and blessings through Jacob. Through Esau, because of his own wickedness, his own desire to fulfill the flesh, sold his own birthright, I have chosen to use as a vessel, not him, but his offspring, as a vessel of destruction. And they destroyed the Israelites in different ways, and then they were destroyed themselves. When we look at Romans 9 in the context of nations, which is where it is written, we start to realize that God is not creating people to go to hell. He may create nations to have hellish adventures, but the individuals within those nations have the same opportunity to hear the gospel and to respond. And we will get more into that, because we get to use specifics now. A man in Egypt called Pharaoh says, "For the scriptures say to the Pharaoh, for this very purpose I've raised you up, that I may show my power in you and that my name may be declared in all the earth. Therefore, he has mercy on whom he wills, and whom he wills, he hardens." We'll come back to that in a sec. "You will say to me then, why does he still find fault?" Right, they're talking about God. "Why does he still find fault? For who has resisted his will?" Right, Paul's saying God is sovereign, and they're saying, well, then how can he find any blame? Right? Who can resist him then? And Paul says, "But indeed, O man, who are you to reply against God?" First he says, hang on, you'd have no idea what's going on here, right? Job, for about 33 chapters, you know, he goes through a lot of stuff, right? And then his whinging gets a bit too much, and God says, look, let me put it this way, and asks him 70 questions. Where were you when I did this? Where were you when I did that? Where were you when I did the stars, the wind, everything? Where were you? And at the end, he's like, what on earth was I thinking to question God? I don't get your logic why I'm suffering, right? Well, I'm sorry, this is God who did all these massive things that you can't get. So if you don't understand it, how dare you point the finger at God? Job never really crossed the line, but he whinged a bit. And by the end, he sort of bowed down and went, oh God, you're right. I don't get it, but... And maybe he never knew on earth that Satan had actually made this challenge and that God wanted to display his glory. And in the end, he blessed Job sevenfold, right? But maybe he never knew that until, well, now he'd probably know it. He would have had, you know, the Lord would, and would have gone, ah... Okay, but God, you know, who can question God? And that's basically what Paul is saying here. He says, who are you to reply against God? Will the thing formed say to him who formed it, why have you made me like this? Does not the potter have power over the clay from the same lump to make one vessel for honor and another for dishonor? And we'll come back to that as well. What if God, wanting to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured with much long suffering the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy which he had prepared beforehand for glory, even us whom he called, not of the Jews only, but also the Gentiles. So it's easy, without understanding the context of how this is written, to sort of go, wow, this is just saying, someone starts accusing God of, hey, why are you doing this? And then it sounds like Paul's going, well, God can harden people's hearts and he can do this and he can make people for hell and he can do whatever because he's the potter, right? That's what on first reading, that's just exactly what it sounds like, right? But when we look into the context, when we look at the co-text, texts that also speak on this, we see it's something totally different. And the way I've just phrased, the way I wanted to address what we've just read then in those 10 verses is through about three questions. The first question is, this is the objection someone might have, right? They would be saying, clay can't complain against the potter. And so we can't complain against our maker, right? So can't God do anything he wants? Isn't that what the scripture's saying? So you can imagine someone coming to you with Romans 9 and going, hey, of course God can make people for hell. What are you talking about? He can do what he likes. It says that he's like the potter and we're like the clay. And we know clay can't complain, right? And we know that God can do anything he wants, right? Okay. It is true that clay can't complain to the potter, just as we have no basis to complain to God. That's true. And of course, God can do whatever he wants to us, including horrifically torture us if he wanted to. But here's the thing, right? But that is not God's character. He is completely sovereign, absolutely, not denying that. But because he is loving, he has sovereignly decided that he wants to make each one of us a vessel of honor. He wants to make all of us. He's chosen all of us. He's chosen to make all of us a vessel of honor. Right? That, of course, he can do that. And yes, we may not have a response back to him. But it would still be true. If God was like that, you could ask the question of which a man called Dave Hunt wrote a book called What Love Is This? And at the beginning of this afternoon, I talked to you about knowing God. And so when you hear a heresy come along, that you can go, that's not my God. My God does not act like that. I know my God. My God is loving and kind. He's absolutely just. He's absolutely righteous. But if I'm reading a certain scripture and it doesn't seem to match the character of my God, let me put it this way. And this isn't my analogy, but just say there was a fireman, right? And he became famous because he was just so good at saving people. He rushed into buildings and saved people. He got so famous in his local area that they promoted him to the state level, and he started doing the same kind of feats. He would save people every single time he was there, and he would save them. And he received much adulation, you know, much praise for what he did. It got to a national level. He got promoted to a national level, and he was doing the same thing. And he was known even on an international stage. This man, just every time, the amount of lives he would save in these fires was incredible. Later on, it was revealed that he not only saved the people from the fires, but he lit the fires to begin with, to save the people. At that point, the praise and honor and glory that they wanted to give this man turned to incredulity, right? It turned to anger. Now, the man had his own free will, and he could have done exactly that. But it doesn't mean that that doesn't say something about that man's character, does it? So for God to be, you know, for us to praise God because he saved all men, but he's the one that designed them as vessels for wrath to go to hell in the first place, and then he comes in and saves the day. I'm sorry, that's an affront to our logic. That's an affront to our reason. That's an affront to what we know of God to be true in our own hearts. God is not lighting the fires on mankind, our own sin, our own choices. God is not some divine puppet master that has controlled every action, including our sins, so that we can really do nothing and that he's justified in doing that, because if we dare say anything, he's saying, hey, the clay can't talk back. What are you saying anything here? We may not be able to complain against God, but we may be able to see, does that match? Does that kind of picture or theology match the picture of our God? The loving one, the one who sent his son, the one who keeps weeping in the Old Testament over his people, you know, or Jesus who came with such compassion. Does that sound like your God? No, my God doesn't sound like the one who sets the fires and saves the people. My God sounds like the one who something terribly went wrong and we set all these fires ourselves and he has come and saved the day, right? And they're the two choices you have when you're looking at these pictures. Now, these scriptures, sorry. I just want to read a quote from Dave Hunt on free will, and this sums it up pretty well for me. Human beings do have something to say about this. We do have the power of choice. Now, there are those of us who deny that we have the power of choice. Luther wrote an entire book about it called The Bondage of the Will. John Calvin also denied that man has the power of choice. Now, when you say that, then you have to go the next step, right? And that is what Calvin taught and what Calvinists say today. God is the cause of everything. He's totally sovereign, right? We can't have choices. Edwin H. Palmer, in his book, The 5 Points of Calvinism, says, God is the author of sin. Does that sound like your God? Everything that happens, happens because God willed it. Even the mistakes of a typist. So now we've turned human experience into a puppet show, practically. But worst of all, it makes God the author of sin. Every evil thought, crime, murder, rape, robbery, and so forth in history, God has foreordained it because man has no will. Man cannot even will to sin. But this is all that God has foreordained. I do not believe that this is what this passage is saying. But it is saying that whatever happens, we can't complain. But also, the Bible tells us that God, he loves mankind. He has the best in mind for us. It is our stubborn rebellion against God that causes these things. Doesn't that put that into perspective? And we look at those scriptures like that. And I think everything must come back to the test of character. Let's look at a second question. Question 2. Verse 22 talks about the vessels of wrath prepared for destruction. Doesn't this mean that God predestines some for salvation and some for destruction? And doesn't the example of Pharaoh prove this? Let's have a look at that. There's three things there. One is salvation predestined? In the scriptures, predestination and election are always connected with God's foreknowledge. Did you know that? Predestination and election, when the Bible talks about I've elected or predestined, it's always associated with God's foreknowledge. In fact, Romans 8 says, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined. Predestined to what? What's the end of that verse? To salvation? whom he foreknew, he also predestined to salvation. That doesn't say that. You probably thought it said that. It says to be conformed to the image of his son. In fact, the Bible doesn't ever tie predestination with salvation anywhere. Predestination and election are always unto a blessing, never unto salvation. Or why would God even mention foreknowledge? Why is he saying, oh, God used his foreknowledge for that? Why would he do that, right? God shouldn't even mention his foreknowledge if he just did it. If he can do what he likes to the clay, why is he using his foreknowledge? The only reason he's using his foreknowledge is he can know who will respond and how they'll respond. And he can put things in place to help that. He's not controlling those decisions. Just because you have foreknowledge doesn't mean that you've gone and changed the future. A knowledge is different to actually changing things. But he had knowledge, and so he could base his actions beforehand, before the foundation of the world even, on what he knew would happen in the future. Like I said, the very mentioning of foreknowledge shows God considered our actions and marked out blessings for those who would respond to the gospel. Second part of that question is destruction predestined? Has God made some vessels for destruction? What does that mean? Well, the ones fitted for destruction are the ones that God knew would have evil hearts and not respond to him. Doesn't that make a whole lot more sense? Isn't that a whole lot more? Honestly, if God didn't mention the word foreknowledge, I get that would be difficult to draw, but that's what he uses. That is the word used, foreknowledge. God is mentioning foreknowledge. He wants to bring the idea or the theology of foreknowledge into this because God is looking forward. Right? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13 also talks about how God chooses us. And it's actually about choosing us, those who believe the truth, basically. Right? How's God choosing us? For those who respond to him. That's how he's choosing us. How many does he want to come into the kingdom? Come on, we all know it in our bones. We're created by him. How many people does God want to save? We all know that, don't we? God doesn't want to create these vessels to burn in hell for eternity, made in the image of God. Ones he mourns over. He doesn't want that. No one can see that. I understand if you're a faithful man of the scriptures, you might have difficulty if you didn't understand two things. One is, it's connected with foreknowledge when we look at it in the scriptures. And secondly, the predestination and election are always unto some kind of blessing to be conformed into the image of the Son. It's all about sanctification after you're saved, not about being saved and how you're saved. It's like God looked into the future and said, of those ones that will choose me, I'm going to transform them into the image of my Son, and I'm going to give them this blessing and that blessing. God has predestined them, and I'm going to call them to go to this person and be this kind of missionary. God has predestined. He has elected them. He has chosen them to do all these kinds of things. But God has not elected or chosen, controlled them to salvation, right? What did we win at the cross? What was restored at the cross? I'll tell you what, before I met Jesus, I had to sin, right? I had no choice but to sin. I may be able to choose how, when, who, with, what, right? But I was a sinner and I sinned, right? But after I became saved, free will was restored to me, power of the Spirit. Free will was restored at the cross, and I could then resist sin. I could put it to death by the power of the Spirit. You see, the thing about Christianity, when you come into Christianity, you don't lose your free will. You're not locked into going to heaven, whether you like it or not, right? Or locked into going to hell from birth, right? Or from the foundation of the earth. The Lord restores free will at the cross. He doesn't remove it. Okay, let's go on to the last part of that question. And it's an interesting one because people go, what about Pharaoh? And that's the question. Part C, what about Pharaoh? And again, I want to quote from one of the guys I think it was the best on some of this stuff, Dave Hunt. and this is how he says it in a radio interview. He says, we go back a ways to Pharaoh. It wasn't that God made Pharaoh be the bad guy that he was, but he knew the heart of Pharaoh, and he arranged for Pharaoh to become Pharaoh just to be there at that time. It does say that he hardened Pharaoh's heart. But on the other hand, Pharaoh hardened his own heart before God did that. In fact, Pharaoh did it three times. Three times he hardened his own heart before God did anything to his heart. And if you go back and read the story, God tells Moses, one of the first things he says is, listen to this, and you may not have spotted it. This is one of the first things God says to Moses. He says, I know he won't let the people go. Well then, why does God harden his heart? If Pharaoh is, as the Calvinists teach, totally depraved, God wouldn't have to harden his heart, would he? Well, Pharaoh is scared to death because the plagues have been so awesome, he would let the people go out of fear, not for the right reason, and his heart wouldn't have changed. So you go back in the Hebrew, and here's what I'd never heard before. You go back in the Hebrew, the word for hardened there means strengthened. Which, when you kind of think about it, if I harden something, I strengthen it, right? Means strengthened. He strengthened. He gave him the courage to keep saying no until God had executed all the judgment he wanted upon the gods of Egypt. He was going to make the decision anyway. God actually strengthened him so God could finish doing all the judgment that he needed to do. And then Pharaoh went and made his own choice in the end. Once again, when we look at the scriptures, when we sometimes look at the Hebrew, when we look at the context, we don't seem to find any scriptures that portray a kind of God that is making vessels for destruction without, you know, having any choice in it whatsoever. And the final question, verse 24 says, he called Jews and Gentiles. Doesn't this mean that only those called by God can be saved? Okay. And here's a quote. He calls all mankind, right? For example, many are called, few are chosen. Judas was even chosen. Jesus said, have not I chosen you 12 and one of you is a devil? When Jesus said, you haven't chosen me, I've chosen you in John 15, when we get to that, Dave Hunt says this, I've had several hundred employees in the past when I was in the business world, and I could say to each one of them, you didn't choose me. That's the same for me. I've got employees, right? I could say, you didn't choose me. I chose you. In other words, they couldn't push themselves on me. I'm the employer. I have the final word. But it doesn't mean that they became my robots. They had to agree to work for me as well. So when we just understand what it is saying with a little common sense, I think it removes the onus from God and making him out to be the puppet master and he is the cause of everything that happens. No, he's not. But he can take these players on a stage that he knows what they will do beforehand and he can put them into where they will fit in his will, but is still their evil that is doing it. Doesn't that make more sense? He knows how people will respond. So he knows he can put a Pharaoh into a situation and that will help bring about a result. He didn't interfere with the choices of Pharaoh. But he put him into that place for that time, right? But he didn't need to interfere with them. Again, on this thing with employers, people come to me, and from my perspective, I've chosen them, right? I've given them the job, but they can go, no, they could talk to their friends and go, well, I chose to work for Mike's business, and they're right too. They did come and choose. They put their resume in, they came. I made the final say, but they also chose. So for me to say I chose all these workers, I absolutely did. But that doesn't mean none of them had any free will or any say in it or are now locked in and have to work for me for eternity, right? And so sometimes we need to go back. If any scriptures start to impugn what we know as the loving God who he is, if anything starts to, oh boy, that doesn't sound like the character of my God, then we've got to go back to the scriptures and just be a little bit more, we've got to dig a little deeper and we've got to look at some other scriptures. Okay, let's get to the end here. So verse 25. As he says in Hosea, I will call them my people who are not my people and her beloved who is not beloved. And it shall come to pass in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people. There they shall be called the sons of the living God. Paul's coming back to this Jew and Gentile and he's going to wrap it up on this. And I'm wrapping it up on this too. He's saying, hey, yeah, Gentiles, I did call you. Hosea prophesied. He was going to grab these people that weren't his people. He was going to grab non-Israelites, Gentiles, and he's going to make them people. Well done. And what you've done here in Rome, that's amazing. That's incredible. But Isaiah said, though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, the remnant will be saved, for he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness. That's his work of judgment. He's going to finish it, not without wiping them out, because the Lord will make a short work upon the earth. And as Isaiah said before, unless the Lord of Sabaoth had left us a seed, we would have become like Sodom and we would have been made like Gomorrah. Paul in this says the remnant will be saved. He's saying, guys, I just affirmed, yes, I know that you are going to be joined in. You are going to become God's people. But do not think what Hosea said meant you are replacing the Jews. That replacement theology is a doctrine of demons. He then affirms here, no, the remnant of Israel will be saved. Israel is on pause kind of thing, right? And God will go back to dealing with them in at the very end. God visits them. They mourn for the one whom they pierced. He has a literal restoration of the kingdom and of the millennial reign. The Jews are will be part of that through Jesus Christ, right? So he affirms them both, and then he finishes with this. What shall we say then? That Gentiles who did not pursue righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness of faith? But Israel, pursuing the law of righteousness, has not attained to the law of righteousness? Why? Because they did not seek it by faith, but as it were, by the works of the law. For they stumbled at that stumbling stone. As it is written, "Behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whoever believes on him will not be put to shame." He wants to correct their thinking here, and he says, God isn't done with the Jews. What happened was the Gentiles, when they heard the gospel, responded in faith. The Jews thought, oh, maybe we can get there through our works plus faith. And so God has gone, look, I can't do that. And Jesus has become a stumbling block. And so there was a lot of Jews who were not responding to the gospel, and this was cutting Paul up. But he was saying, this is really cutting me up, but don't let it exclude the true Jews, those that are really wanting to join this church, right? Don't kick them out. Don't set up a second denomination. It'll spread everywhere. It'll be a form of racism that we don't want. And let me say this, after explaining that both Gentile and Jews who become the true seed of Abraham by faith shall be saved, he explains that the reverse is true, that just being born a Jew is not enough, and in fact the world is no longer to be split. And this is a really important point I want you to get. I know you've been listening for a bit, but just grab this. The world is no longer to be split into the two people groups of Jew and Gentile. And in all of God's history, that's what it was like, Jew and Gentile, right? But instead, the two people groups that God sees is those now born of the promise, which is mixed up of Jew and Gentile, born of the promise through faith who will inherit salvation, and those born of the flesh who are like Esau, who could be Jew or Gentile, who will inherit destruction. They are the two people groups that God sees. He doesn't see Jew and Gentile. It's a great answer for racism in our day. It doesn't have to be Jew and Gentile. Right? We divide the world in all different kinds of ways. God sees it only, he sees two groups, and they're not like us, they're spiritual groups. There's those destined for salvation and those destined for destruction. Right? We have a choice in that because God wants everyone. Right? God so loved the world that he sent his only son, that whomever believes in him shall have eternal life. And this is how we put sovereignty and free will together in this statement. God has sovereignly declared that all mankind belongs to only one of these two groups, right? God has decided. He set it all up. He said, you're going to destruction or you're going to salvation. I have set that up. I am sovereign. It's my rules. I am sovereign, right? I affirm the sovereignty of God here. But to which group we belong is ultimately ours to choose, right? Doesn't that make sense? Doesn't that make sense about the character of God, of who God is? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your holy word, Lord. Lord, we just pray that in these sometimes difficult scriptures, Lord, we have the Holy Spirit of God. And Lord, you teach us, Lord. You told us that, Lord, we have an anointing from the Holy One and therefore we need no teacher, but the Holy Spirit will teach us. The Holy Spirit reminds disciples of things that you said, Lord, and puts together the scriptures. He brings light and revelation and understanding into the scriptures. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us, Lord, to understand these things even more and to understand the character of God, the God who is so perfect, so righteous, so just, so holy in judgment, is also the God who is so loving, so merciful, who just longs that none would perish, but that all would come to repentance. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.